My first year in Pennsylvania. All right, so my running history now takes me to Emmaus, Pennsylvania, August of 1985. I just had a successful Grandma's Marathon in June of 1985, and when Rodale Press flew a few of us out to check out the facilities before we confirmed that we were in fact moving, I was able to run as part of the Manufacturer Hanover's 3.5-mile corporate challenge on the Rodale Press team, which was cool. And this 3.5-mile race was pretty prolific. You had some really good runners. Supposedly everyone that ran had to be an employee, a confirmed 40-hour-a-week employee of whatever company they ran for. I think for the most part that was true, but in some cases, I'm sure there were some ringers. We had a ringer that actually worked 50 to 60 hours a week, our fitness director, Bud Coates. Bud actually finished second on that particular Manufacturers Hanover qualifying series race to, I can't believe I can't remember this guy's name. Anyway, I'll mention that in a future episode of the Emmaus years. But Bud was an incredible runner, a 2:13 marathoner at Boston one year. My friend Sil Pascal reminded me that Bud actually ran 2:14 in the Cal International Marathon in 1989 and won the race. So we had quite an impressive fitness director at Rodale Press, and he worked hard. Bud actually provided fitness programs and coaching advice for all of the Rodale employees that wished to make use of his services. He and his wife, Ellen, put me up for the first 3 weeks I lived in Emmaus until my apartment became available. And their dog, Bakila, named after the great Ethiopian runner, Abibi Bakila, would often go on training runs with Bud and me. Bud showed me all the trails around Emmaus. And guys, Emmaus is a wonderful area for runners. Numerous trails, beautiful roads, country roads to run on. You can actually run among the cornfields in the summertime. It's quite incredible. There is a mountain just behind Rodale Press. I believe it's called South Mountain. And we would run up and down that mountain for some of our longer runs. Incredibly steep, and going up and down was a challenge. You had to definitely make sure that you knew what you were doing and watch your step occasion, because there were a few potholes. This was a county road, not a state highway. So my first year at Rodale Press, Runner's World took my position that I talked about before, sports marketing, race co-sponsorship director, and took it to a new level. We actually flew to many races. Rodale Press flew me out to many of the events that we were co-sponsoring, and I would work at the expo, and then I would get to run in the race. So that's pretty cool, getting free travel to these races all around the country. I often ran them with tired legs, though, because you're standing on your feet all day for 2 or 3 days before the race at the expos, meeting people. It's a wonderful job. And I saw many new places, traveled as many as 36 weekends a year, I think was my record. So I was quite busy. Even the travel days were basically like a work day. You weren't really getting any rest, and then you're back to work on Monday. So there wasn't a lot of time off in that particular job. Paid well, totally enjoyed the experience, and was there for a total of 3 years. So the early years at Rodale, I mentioned the fitness minded community, the cafeteria, the restaurant, the house that was a restaurant, the employees that were all into fitness for the most part, and our Manufacturers Hanover corporate team that qualified in that particular June-July race actually ran the World Championships, the Manufacturers Hanover's World Championships in the fall. We were all put up in the Plaza Hotel. If you've ever seen Crocodile Dundee, that's the exclusive, expensive hotel just off of Central Park, and we were housed there for free. They gave us a big banquet the night before. The race was incredible. My gosh, I ran sub 5 minute pace for 3.5 miles and maybe finished in the top 70. It was incredible. The field was just incredibly fast. Bud was top 5 overall in the World Championships, and our team actually placed as a team. I think we were 3rd as a team overall, but we definitely got a big trophy. Got her photos in all the manufacturers, Hanover literature, and that was quite an experience with Bud and Pat Capora and a few other runners that I can't remember the names of at the moment, but we actually were pretty good, especially for people who literally did work over 40 hours a week. So that was the Manny Hanny series. Work. We eventually were able to sign over 200 races at peak when I was there, and many of those were the big races. Peachtree Road Race, we helped out at the Boston Marathon, had a big booth at the expo at the Boston Marathon. There were smaller races that I went to as well as sort of the face of Runner's World. Guys, the reason I bring this up, this particular job was taken over when I eventually left 3 years later by one Bart Yasso. Yes, Bart Yasso, the Bart Yasso, the face of Runner's World. He took the job, the position, to an entirely new level once I left, and I'm very proud of what Bart has done. That's something that I never would have been able to achieve. I won't even try to pretend that I would ever have been a Bart Yasso, but the genesis of that particular position was actually mine, and that started back in Mountain View, California, under Bob Anderson and Derek Clayton. So kudos to them, and kudos to Bart, who's retiring now. He may actually have officially retired, but this was definitely going to be his last year at Runner's World Magazine. Bart is a familiar face around the country at various races of various distances. So that was my work experience at Runner's World during those 3 years. I mentioned Bud Coates before, Pat Capora. We often went as a team, Team Rodale Press, to races such as the Philadelphia Half Marathon. That particular race was special to me because for the second time in my running career, once in the 1981 Boston Marathon, again at the 1985 Philadelphia Distance Run Half Marathon, and then in the Beta Breakers race in 1988, I ran beside and with most of the way one Joan Benoit Samuelson later, and we actually crossed the finish line together. I wasn't trying to necessarily nip her at the finish line, nor was she trying to beat me. We actually worked together and would cross the finish line together in those particular races, both pushing each other, and she was a much more talented runner than I, obviously the best in the world. And it's funny because people used to say, oh, you got chick. I said, guys, here's the deal. First of all, as with Allison Rowe years before, this is the best female runner in the world. Secondly, we crossed the line together. Oh, but she was listed ahead of you in the results. Yes, because guess what? Her name started with a B, Benoit. My name started with a W, Wrinkle. Even when she changed her name to Benoit Samuelson, she still nipped me alphabetically. And those three races were amazing races and experiences for me because I was running with Joan Benoit. And of course, I got all the cheers because, well, I was surrounded by all the cheers because guess who they're cheering for? Joan Benoit. We were similar speeds in the marathon, half marathon. That particular half marathon, Philadelphia Distance Run, we ran 108.45, my personal best. I knocked a couple of minutes off my personal best, actually, and I was thrilled with that particular time. Less than a month later, she went on to run her 2:21 at the Chicago Marathon, world record at the time. So, Joan Benoit Samuelson. We had met years before through Bob 70, when Joni came out for her surgery, and 17 days after that knee surgery, she qualified for the Olympic team in 1984 and then went on to win the first women's Olympic marathon in Los Angeles in 1984. So thank you, Bob 70, for introducing us. Joan Benoit Samuelson, incredible athlete. And we didn't know each other in 81 when we ran that Boston Marathon, much of it together, the last several miles for sure. But we definitely, introduced ourselves and sort of, became acquaintances, but I didn't really get to know her until she came out for her surgery. She spent some time training those 17 days with Bob 70, and I'm rambling a little bit, but what an incredible human being, Joan Benoit Samuelson, as nice in person as she was fierce a competitor on the roads. Joni, one of my all-time running heroes or heroines, as it might be. So that's the end of part one about Emmaus, Pennsylvania. I talk about some of the trails, some of the running experiences in the next episode, and then eventually move on to my 28-year teaching career after leaving Runner's World. Cheers.